many people start martial arts either because they want to beat up people or because they're afraid of being beaten up.
Hello, and thank you for tuning in to Whistlekick Martial Arts Radio. This is episode 234, and today's guest is another international one. A little bit of an accent, but I know you're going to be able to understand, and I know you're going to want to stick around because it's an awesome story of someone who started life in one part of the world, moved to another part of the world, and it's all because of their love of martial arts. If you're new to the show, my name's Jeremy Lesniak. I'm your host here for Martial Arts Radio. I'm also the founder of Whistlekick Sparring Gear and Apparel, where we like to say we make the world's best sparring gear, and we make some great, fun, functional apparel, accessories, new stuff always on the way, and you can check out everything we're doing at whistlekick.com. You can find the other 233 episodes, show notes, photos, videos, and so much more at whistlekickmartialartsradio.com. No hyphens, no spaces, no weird spellings or anything like that. We like to keep our domain names easy. If you want to check us out on social media, we are at Whistlekick on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, and Instagram. We're also hanging around some other places like Google Plus and Tumblr and... did I say Twitter? We're on Twitter. We're pretty much everywhere. We don't interact as much in all of them, but let's be honest. Not everybody uses every version of social media. Some of you may not use social media at all. And that's why we have our websites. That's why we have email. You can email me directly, jeremy@whistlekick.com. I still reply to every email I get. I love hearing feedback. Love hearing love letters. Not really. They're not love letters. Thank you letters. The whatever the opposite of hate mail is. Get a little bit of that. Not too much. Our guest today has a unique and interesting story. He jumped from martial art to sport and then to martial arts again. Then he jumped to the other side of the world. Sensei Guillaume Erard trained in Judo as a kid, living in France, but developed such a strong love for Japanese culture that he decided to live there. As a contemplative Aikido instructor and practitioner, Sensei Erard has found his home in Japan. So let's welcome him. Sensei Erard, welcome to Whistlekick Yes. Martial Arts Radio.
Hello, thank you for having me.
Well, thank you for coming on the show. Thank you. We are kind of bookending the long edges of a workday, because as the listeners may be able to tell, you have an accent. You are Indeed. Not from right here. You know, you're not down the street. You're not in New York City or something. But you're actually not from where they're going to think you're from, at least not today. No. you know, here I have to be honest, this is the earliest I have conducted an interview for this show, and it's a completely different time there. So here it is 6 a.m. on the east coast of the U.S., and what time is it there, and where are you?
Oh, we are 7 p.m. on the dot. So, I'm in Tokyo right now.
Yeah, so here we've got our first actual interview coming out of Japan. We've had folks from Japan on the show, but never someone in Japan. Mm-hmm. And actually, that's going to change. We have someone else even lined up, someone that actually you know. You may not even know that I'm going to talk to them, but somebody that I'm aware that you know is coming on the show in a couple weeks.
All right. Well, leave the surprise and discover who it is.
we never disclose who's coming on before it happens, just in case. Don't want to jinx it.
Yeah.
Well, I'm glad you're here. I appreciate you coming on, and I know we're going to hear all about you. Before we do it, you know, we always start in that kind of really simple, obvious way, but it gives us context for who you are and everything else we're going to talk about. How did you get started in the martial arts?
quite early on, I think it was around the age of six. In fact, I didn't have much of a choice. I think my mom just registered me in a judo place, and I started judo from the age of six. I grew to like it. I started to read a little bit about Japanese culture and all that, and you know, before I knew it, I was hooked on more perhaps than judo itself, the whole Japanese culture. It's grown into a sort of lifetime interest, actually, because after I stopped doing judo, the interest was still there, and then I moved on to other martial arts. So that just started like this. I mean, you might not know that, but in France, judo, especially at the time when I was a child, judo was huge. Like it was one of the, you know, the big three sports that you would do. Like you'd do soccer and probably basketball, and then the third one was probably judo. And it's still quite massive in France. So yeah, that was the way, you know, me and a lot of my peers have started martial arts. So then then after that, you know, doing judo, competing, all that, I grew a little bit tired of it. Two things: the competition was not really for me. Like I don't think I have that in me, that need to dominate someone. So that was something I never felt too comfortable with. And I was more interested in the, you know, technical aspect, the old techniques and all. But at the end of the day, the way judo was taught and done was very physical, and you know, you had your set of, you know, 3-4 techniques that you would always do the same in competition, and they would usually work. And there was something missing. So I left judo for a while, went into something completely different. I went to do water polo, which I liked because it was quite physical. So I quite enjoyed that. And after that, around the age of 15, I decided to stop water polo and to do another martial art. So I had that old keikogi still from my old days, and I thought, you know, I really want to put that thing on again. So I remember I went home one night and said to my parents, I said, okay, look, I'm gonna stop water polo and I want to start martial arts. So, you know, my mom looks at me and she says, oh, okay, what do you want to do? And I said I want to start Aikido. And then my stepfather looked at me and he said, no, really? I said, yeah, you know about Aikido? And he said, yes, actually I do, because my best friend is a fifth dan. And, you know, from then that I was sorted. You know, I went to see his friend the week after and registered and never quit since. The reason why I chose Aikido was because, well, I had done judo, and the big threes in France were, of course, you know, judo, karate, and Aikido. But it seemed to me that everybody was doing karate, and I wanted something a bit more obscure. And, you know, in Aikido, we're wearing the hakama, the white pants. And there's quite a bit of practice with weapons like the wooden sword, the stick, and that looked quite, you know, mysterious to me, especially at the time. You know, now it's more well known, but at the time we didn't have internet and all that, so it was more obscure. So I thought, okay, I'm gonna try that. And I looked at a few demonstrations. Like in France, we used to have that massive festival in Paris, in Bercy, where you saw a lot of the most prominent teachers in all martial arts, not only Japanese, demonstrate every year. And I used to watch the Aikido demonstration by someone who's called Christian Tissier, who's the highest ranked French practitioner, who spent quite a lot of time in Japan as well. I mean, I'm very much in his footsteps in many ways. So he impressed me very much, and I wanted to do what he did. So that's where I started, basically.
Okay. I want to go to a time that I think is a pretty important time in that timeline you just gave us. And that's the point where you decided you wanted to stop water polo and go back into martial arts.
Mm.
Because the time in your life that happened is not a time that most people choose to enter, certainly not re-enter martial arts. At least in America. Yeah. I guess I can't speak to the rest of the world, but here in America, mm-hmm. when people join martial arts typically as young children, and as mm-hmm. they become teenagers, it is less popular here, mm-hmm. and then they will often pick it back up as an adult. What was it that you had remembered from your time in judo that you missed that made you want to try Aikido?
It's an interesting question. There are many things from within and without judo. From within judo, I can remember, you know, as I said, the Japanese cultural thing, that's a big thing. I mean, that's certainly what underlies everything I do, that culture. Just the smell of the tatami, the feeling of wearing that keikogi and all these things. I did miss it. As far as why I stopped water polo is because it's the same thing as the competition. I mean, water polo in many ways was way rougher than anything I'd done in judo before. I mean, it is. I never got really injured in judo. I did get injured in water polo, so I was a bit tired of all that. And you know, there's that competing element as well that I didn't like that much in judo, and I didn't like it, you know, anymore in water polo. So you know, along with starting Aikido, there was also the thing that, you know, as you may know, there is no competition in Aikido, at least in the Aikido that I do, and that was very appealing to me because I had done competition for most of them of my life at the time. I knew what it was, and I knew what was good about it, what I didn't like, and I made the conscious decision to stop competing. In other words, I did not, you know, I made the decision not to have anything to prove to anyone else but myself from that point on. Because what does it mean to compete? You know, sometimes you win, sometimes you lose. Does that make you a winner or loser? Of course, you can't, you know, qualify yourself in such way. One day you win, one day you lose. So I found it pretty pointless at the end. And I figured, you know, I've got pretty stringent criteria and expectations for myself. And I think they're actually higher than a lot of the standards which are out there. And I thought, you know, I think I've got it in me to still go forward without the incentive of winning a title or something like that. So that was part of it. And again, you know, getting back to the Japanese culture, the feeling of the tatami under your feet, you know, the grappling element, the holding someone, you know, like that one-to-one sort of contact, that was quite appealing.
When you first talked about judo, you said that you didn't have a choice.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
What did you mean by that?
Well, at that age, 6 years old, you don't really know what you want to do or what you don't want to do. Certainly in France, you're expected to do one or two sports at that age. And I don't know. I mean, you know, judo probably seemed like a good thing to do to my mom. I never asked her why she thought that, you know, judo was a better idea than, you know, putting me in the local soccer club. I reckon perhaps because she also felt that, you know, everybody was doing soccer and perhaps there was something, you know, different for me, a different path. And I appreciate that, I think. And apart from that, really, I mean, judo was really not a choice of mine. I grew into it, but yeah.
Now, clearly, in Aikido, you found something that you love. You're still practicing it now. And you've mentioned the culture elements of martial arts a couple times. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to guess that your move to Japan had at least some part to do with that.
Yeah, I mean, you put it exactly right. It has some part in it. A lot of people assume that I moved to Japan because exclusively of Aikido, which is not true at all. I went to Japan because of Japan, because I thought, you know, you are studying a Japanese cultural property. You know, the Japanese, they call that mukei bunkazai. It's the intangible cultural property. It's an item, Japanese culture. And to me, I couldn't see how you could get really deep within that subject if you did not study the Japanese language and study in Japan. Now, in many respects, there is lots to learn abroad. I mean, we know like the US and France are probably the two first countries, perhaps with Brazil, where, you know, Budo got exported, Budo got taught. So we got pretty long lineage and very, very competent teachers. But there is sometimes a little cultural element missing, and I thought I want to get that element as well. So that was certainly a part of the reason why I moved to Japan. But really, since, you know, going back to my judo days and reading, you know, magazines about Japan, and, you know, every month you'd have a couple of Japanese words that, you know, they would explain to you and so on, and perhaps even a little kanji writing card or something. And I thought, you know, I want to learn that stuff in many ways. It felt, for some reason, I have no idea why, but Japan seemed to be, or my idea of Japan, you know, as inaccurate as it was at the time, seemed to be the right place for me to be. And some in many ways, I thought, you know, my goal in life when I was like, you know, 10 years old and so on, I want to become Japanese. So that was pretty strong drive.
So it almost seems like it's the opposite of what I would expect from most people. You resumed martial arts training because of your interest in Japan, not the other way.
Yes, I would be dishonest with you if I didn't mention the martial aspect as well. I believe, and you know, and perhaps this is just a bias on my part, you know, but I believe that you start a martial arts. Many people start martial arts either because they want to beat up people, or because they're afraid of being beaten up. If I see a lot of people who don't know martial arts, and to me, if they don't have that need to learn potentially destructive techniques, in other words, techniques designed to harm a fellow human being, if you are willing to spend time learning those techniques, you have to question the motivation behind. You don't get that for free, right? You must be open to the question. And, you know, I certainly, the answer to me was that I was, in 15 and not very confident person, kid, not very good at school either, not much luck with the girls, all that, much insecurity. And I felt, I'm going to become, strong with that. I'm going to become a better person in terms of, a stronger person and a more confident person. That was a big, big motivation for me. I thought, if I can define myself as a martial artist, as this sort of, like white pants wearing black belt thing, that's going to project an image of myself that I can live with. So that was my part of the motivation. I didn't want to beat up people, but certainly I felt insecure enough for having that drive in me to start a martial arts. I think that's a significant part of it.
You know, I may be making an overgeneralization here because I don't have a lot of examples to draw from, but the folks that we've spoken to on the show that have found their way into Aikido, the friends of mine that I have that train in Aikido that have not been on the show, all seem to have a very similar story. There seems to be something about Aikido that attracts and really takes hold of people of a very particular mindset.
Mm-hmm.
And I find that interesting.
Well, in a way, Aikido is pretty straightforward in its message. A lot of them are like this, but it's a wa no budo, wa meaning harmony in Japanese. It is not designed to beat people up, to attack people. It is something associated with self-defense. So I think it takes a certain type of person to actually start from that postulate. Whereas I can see more easily, karate or kung fu to be used for offensive means, even though they're not designed for that. But you probably get more of a mixed bag in those schools compared to Aikido. I think you sign up, if you know where you're going, you know where you're what you're getting into. Really, the message of Aikido and its founder is pretty clear. Mm-hmm. So I think that probably explains that your assessment of the people who do Aikido.
Sure, that makes sense. I think we've got a pretty good idea who you are, how you found your way into martial arts, and now it's story time.
All right.
Here on Martial Arts Radio, we love stories. I love stories. I founded the show because I love hearing martial arts stories. So I would love to hear your favorite martial arts story.
A good friend of mine who's who used to do Aikido is an author. Quite friendly. You might know actually him. He's Lissam Dur. He told me once when we talked, he said the most important part about my life should be my life, as opposed to his martial arts training and all that. Now, thinking about your question, that makes me realize that in many ways, my life is, intertwined with Aikido. Aikido is my life and my life benefits from Aikido, but my life doesn't rely on Aikido. But I think if you want a story, I think this is the way Aikido, the practice of Aikido, has allowed me to make the most of my time as a human being, and to end up now in a place where I am happy where I am, and when I get up in the morning, I am happy to go where I'm going. And suddenly, that's been through Aikido, and so in other words, my whole life story, which through my contacts, the people I met through Aikido, the sort of state of mind that Aikido has given me, to have that sort of approach to situations that will yield the most satisfactory results without unnecessary conflicts, without burning bridges if you don't have to, and that kind of thing. So really, my biggest accomplishment, if you like, is to have been able to to stay somewhat truthful to that child's dream, the child who wanted to become somewhat Japanese. I'm not Japanese, but I think I didn't disappoint that child, and that's because of Aikido. I mean, in many, many ways, I think that's a major thing. Without having picked up Aikido at that time, my life would be very different, and I think it might be very, very good, but it would not have been as truthful compared to the image that child had of its own future. So that, I think, that's the most important thing, important story with my martial arts background. Now, I could tell you about stories, little fights and things like that, but I don't think that there's much of a point in there. Usually you find that when you find yourself in conflictual situations, most of the time you have some bearing in that situation. And if you had been a bit smarter, you probably wouldn't have ended in that situation.
Outside of martial arts, what are mm-hmm. you passionate about? Do you have hobbies or things that take your time?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I always think, the day I get injured and I can't step on the tatami anymore, or again, just the day where I'm just fed up with the whole thing. There's so much, so many things that I could potentially spend my time doing. Like I've taken up, filmmaking. I bought a camera. I had no idea how to use a DSLR or make videos, but I really enjoyed it. And to a large extent, it's what made me somewhat known within the Aikido community, that I produce those videos, I interview those sensei and so on. So that's a big thing. I love filmmaking. And I've got a bit of a musician in me as well, so I also write music, which is pretty convenient to stick on those videos and not getting a copyright strike on YouTube. So these are the two major things that I have on top of Aikido. But I've, like everything else in my life, I try to merge these together, and then what I produce in terms of content for Aikido kind of has all of those aspects of my personality in them. They're very much reflection of what I am, basically.
Cool. And of course, we'll make sure we drop a link to your YouTube channel in the show notes.
Right. Thank you very much.
And anyone that's listening, in the car or something, you don't have to worry about mm-hmm. jotting that down. Whistlekickmartialartsradio.com is where we put all those. So okay. Don't sweat. No need to have to take notes while you're in traffic. One of the things that is maybe not unique, but very pervasive in the martial arts is the ability to reflect on our training as we go through difficult times.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like you to tell us about a difficult time of yours and how your martial arts was helpful.
Ah, yeah. Interesting question. Yeah. Many ways. In a way, that Aikido practice, that's grounded me in all those periods of my life where, sometimes you get rougher times, and I've moved quite a bit as well. Like, I left France when I was, I don't know, like 22, went to England to do my undergraduate studies. Then I moved to Ireland, I did my PhD there, then moved to Japan. And even within the same country, I didn't stay in the same city for more than a year or so. Many things changed, and the only thing that stayed the same, besides my family, was Aikido practice. Every single time I moved to a different place, looked at the local dojos, went to all of them and, you know, registered to one or two of them. And that created a social circle. I created contacts. And I got a lot of my, you know, support from that really grounding. And whenever, you know, I was a bit uncertain about my life, or perhaps, I mean, I don't know if depressed is the appropriate word. I don't think I'm ever depressed, but uncertain. Aikido was the thing I was, you know, I knew I had. And the beauty of it is that this is katageko. Katageko in Japanese, this is we are practicing through the repetition of form. In other words, there are a certain number of codes. They can be etiquette. They can be the uniform. They can be the name of the techniques. But there is also a mutual agreement between practitioners of Aikido in which we are helping each other to improve. I am lending my body to my partner so that my partner can work on what they have to work on. And, you know, 50% of the time is the other way around. So with that basis, which is a mutual understanding everywhere you go in an Aikido dojo, that creates really fruitful relationships and a growth medium wherever you are. Even, you know, sometimes you get a bit less money, sometimes you get, you know, problem with work or your studies, but that remains. I think it's largely due to that katageko and the lack of competition. You never have to worry about, at some point, having to face someone in a winners or lose situation. We either both winners, we've had a good practice, we've understood each other. Even if your practice is different from mine, it's my job not to be judgmental of it. And it's my job to still give you a good way to develop whatever it is you're developing. And that is, once again, mutually beneficial. You must be understanding of other people's technique and style and whatever. If you're not going to learn something from that style, at least you must not be offended by what you see or what you feel in your body, because you're lending your body to your partner. And that really, I think, changes you as an individual to be able to behave like that. And let's face it, in Aikido and, you know, in many martial arts, you can get reach proficiency pretty quickly. That is not what the character, the Do character, Michi in Japanese, the way. That is not what the way is about. You will learn the technique in 5-6 years if you're, you know, competent enough and dedicated enough. But for the next 74 years after that, what is it you're doing? And what you're doing is developing that Michi, that Do. It's the way you're doing the techniques and the way you're behaving. So the difficulty is not in learning the techniques. It's in staying open and being able to do your technique on anybody regardless where they're from, and to receive the technique of anybody regardless where they're from. And that's the major difficulty, because we always thrown back to our own models and our own certainties. And when we see something different, we start to judge and, oh, that doesn't work, or that's not the way it's supposed to be, or blah, blah, blah. And, you know, and if you've ever been on YouTube, on martial arts video in YouTube, that, you know, the whole situation exacerbates very, very quickly. And it's built in within Aikido to try to go beyond that.
One of the things that I appreciate, and you articulated it pretty well there, one of the things I love about Aikido, Judo, Jiu-Jitsu, is that you can't do them by yourself.
Indeed, yeah.
You're going to be a pretty poor Judo player, a pretty poor Aikidoka, if you're doing it by yourself at home.
Oh, yeah. But same goes for karate, same goes for even the Koryu, the old martial arts. This is the teaching method in Japan, this is katageko. It's a repetition of the form, and a lot of the time it's actually two people. You're not going to get very far in karate if you work alone. And I think that's quite important. Now, I'm not that knowledgeable, to be honest, in other martial arts, so I'm not going to, you know, go beyond my own level of expertise. But that katageko is really the core of what you do in Budo in Japan. That's really important. And, you know, one other thing is that, I mean, Budo, the way we think of them, like in Karate-do, in Aikido, in Sumo-do, and all those, they are very recent, right? They were formulated before or during the Second World War within a very peculiar context, and they had to change somehow to fit the times, both politically and in the way that they're pretty much useless on the battlefield. And in Japan, there is that say which says, you know, Ningen Keisei no Michi, which is the way of development as human being. It's developing you as a human being. So you use the medium of Budo, of the martial technique, and you get to the core of what it is to be human. And that's where concerns of efficacy and who is the best martial arts, they're really, not only they fall flat, but they're non-pertinent. They don't have a place in the discussion because that is not what Budo were formulated for. And to actually, if you look back in history, you'd be surprised to find that even the older martial ways, the Koryu, also have that element in them of the betterment of human being. And regardless of your style, if you're saying that you're going to do a Japanese Budo, you must acknowledge this. You may have more or less martiality within it, but if you don't acknowledge it, you're missing the point of what Budo is. And that's true for Aikido because it's probably more explicitly displayed, but it's in all Japanese Budo.
I agree. I won't even reiterate or attempt to add to that because you said it perfectly. I'd like to talk about your influences. Mm-hmm. You know, certainly your parents were pretty influential, saying you are going to do judo, not giving you the choice. And hopefully you would have found it. And you know, I tend to believe in fate, at least to a certain degree. So I'm going to believe that you would have found Aikido regardless of that. And your first mm-hmm. instructor, you know, and your instructor in judo, and you know, your stepfather's friend who taught Aikido, certainly big influences in your life.
Mm-hmm.
But if we were to name somebody else, somebody that might be on the fringe, that was influential in your martial arts, shaped you into who you are now, who would that be?
Are we talking about somebody who is not directly a teacher?
It could be a teacher. I like to pull out those obvious answers. You know, my first instructor, if I say who was if you were to ask me who were the most influential martial mm-hmm. artist in my mm-hmm. life was, it would be my first instructor. But that's, mm-hmm. it's about the stories, as you know. So that's not really where the best stories seem to come from. So I like to cross those people off the list.
I see. Okay, there is someone, and I've mentioned it before, who's called Christian Tissier. He came to Japan in the late 60s. He stayed a good few years and went back to France and taught Aikido. And now he's the highest ranked Aikido practitioner in France. And he was one of the very, very first non-Japanese to be awarded a seventh dan and an eighth dan by the Japanese. And that person's been an example ever since I started Aikido. You know, I told you that I watched his demonstrations on VHS, and I thought, oh, that's what I want to do. And, you know, always thought, oh, he went to Japan, and you know, I lived in Japan, and he can speak Japanese. I can remember one day I went to a seminar of his long, long time ago. He just grabs somebody by the sleeve and looks at their name written in Japanese and says, oh, hello, Olivier. Like, now he can read Japanese. That's so great. And so he was in the back of my mind. I was not a student of his at the time. I was even actually in a different school. And sometimes schools being schools, you know, I kind of, you know, I didn't tell my sensei that I was going to his seminars because it was a different school and you were not supposed to do it. But I went nonetheless. I had his books and stuff. And then always wanted to become, you know, one of his top students. I want to be the next generation. But for some reason, that never worked out. I met him when I was living in Ireland, of all places, you know, him being French and me being French. Formally met him at the time. I was actually organizing a seminar, and actually we had him over to Ireland. And, you know, started to go into his group and to take his seminars, take a little bit of ukemi for him and so on. But for some reason, that affiliation never happened. First, I was not living in Paris where he's teaching, and perhaps he didn't see in me something that he needed, which is perfectly fine. But our paths have been close ever since. Because, you know, I live in Tokyo. I practice at the world headquarters in Shinjuku. Very, very often. So whenever he goes, we see each other. And we've developed through the years that sort of relationship, which is not a teacher-student relationship, even though I would say that my Aikido is very, very heavily influenced by his, but not formally. I can't call myself his student, but in many ways, even though at the time I would have wished to be his student, I like to think that I'm a little more than that now. We've got, when we meet, it's not a friendship because he's much older than me, so I wouldn't, you know, claim that friendship. But it's not a teacher-student relationship. It's something which basically it's a how would you call that? It's a guide in a way, intangible guide. I follow many of his footsteps in many ways. I'm very much after getting feedback from him when I do something or something. I'm always interested to hear what he thinks about what I'm doing. And in several occasions, he's been very helpful to me, even when as far as lending me his dojo for free one day that I was supposed to teach a seminar in Paris, and suddenly we lost the training hall, and he said, "That's no problem, take my dojo," and which is a very, very famous place in France, and like a nobody like me going to teach there, it was like a big, big thing for me at least. So really, very, very strong influence, and in a way, guide and a standard as well, but not really a teacher in the formal sense of the way. I think that's the best answer I can give to your question.
And those are the exact kind of answers that I hope for when I ask this mm-hmm. question. So thank you. It's clear that there's a lot of respect that you have for this gentleman.
Mm-hmm.
And I could hear as you were talking, you know, there was some reverence for his skill
mm-hmm.
when you were younger. But the way you're talking about him now doesn't, it sounds like your appreciation for him, even as a martial artist, is about a lot more than his skill. It's more about
yes.
who he is. So can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Well, he's one of the person, so two things. He's one of the persons who've managed the best to come on an equal footing with the Japanese on their own turf, in their own terms. It is easy to perhaps break off, start your own thing, and be the top of your own organization. He never did that. He stayed in Japan. He stayed with Japan. He's living in France. But always paid due respect to the Ueshiba family, the family of the founder of Aikido, to the Aikikai, which is the head organization in Japan of Aikido. When he could really, he had the fame, he had the number of students to break off on his own and do very well for himself. He never did that. He respected his house, and to me, that's a huge source of respect. I've seen a lot of people break off for good reason, bad reason, a lot of it ego driven. He never did that, and I'm pretty sure that life has not been particularly easy on him as well, particularly dealing with Japanese people, and especially the martial arts in Japan, which are very, very special in the way that they deal with things. They're very archaic in many ways. So yes, there is the technical ability. There is the fact that he managed to come to Japan. He learned Japanese in a time when it was a lot harder than when I came. He went to Japan by train. He took the Trans-Siberian. It took forever. Whereas I can be back to Paris in 11 hours, So yeah, sure, a lot of respect and the fact that he did not yield to the temptation. I mean, I'm pretty sure that it happened of breaking off. It is easy to be a big fish in a small pond. It's a lot harder to to keep working with the large group of people and accept the hierarchy. It's a big thing in Japan. You cannot skip ranks. And even somebody who's not as competent as you, if they are your senpai, if you're a senior, they will always be your senpai. And you have to deal with them with the respect that is due to a senior. Even if you're training harder, you're better, you're smarter, it doesn't matter. And that's a big source of teaching for me. You've mentioned it, like culture is a huge part of what I do, and I could recognize that culture within what he was doing. And I'm trying, to stick to the standards that he set for himself for my own way.
If you could train with someone that you haven't, someone anywhere in the world, any style, anywhere in time, they can be alive or dead.
Yeah.
Who would you want to train with?
It's going to require a bit of an explanation. So to answer the question, I would like to meet someone called Takeda Sokaku. Takeda Sokaku was the teacher of Ueshiba Morihei, the founder of Aikido. He was teaching a martial art which was called Daitoryu Aikijujutsu. And, you know, 99% of the techniques taught in Aikido are directly taken off the Daitoryu Aikijujutsu curriculum. The Daitoryu Aikijujutsu curriculum is much, much more extensive. Thousands and thousands of techniques. But really, there's a very strong affiliation there. And, you know, nobody understood what Ueshiba was doing. You can ask any of his students. There are still some who are alive. And you'll get always the same answer. It was very hard to understand what he was saying. Very hard to understand what he was doing. I'm doing my best. Okay? So clearly, something got lost. I tried to study with as many of the direct students of O-sensei, those who are left. That's partly why I'm in Japan as well. But I want to go further because of the culture and because of the history. So I am also a student of Daitoryu Aikijujutsu. I was lucky enough to be accepted to one of those schools, one of the main branches of Daitoryu. And I am able to study the older forms of Aikido, in other words, and to study the techniques that were not put in the Aikido curriculum by Ueshiba, either the founder or his son. And by understanding which technique they put in Aikido, which technique they didn't put in Aikido, and the changes they made between techniques, that I think gives me an edge in understanding what was in the head of Ueshiba when he formulated Aikido. And of course, you know, what I really want to know is how did it feel to receive techniques from somebody who could actually throw Ueshiba like he was nothing. In other words, there is the whole concept of Aiki in Japanese. It's a sort of old and fuzzy concept, but it's formulated quite well in Daitoryu. So, you know, the past of Takeda Sokaku is quite unclear. Did he transmit a very old martial art, or did he make it up? You know, historians are debating. I've got my own opinion. It's worth what it's worth. But what's really interesting is where did he get the skills, the undeniable skills that he had? What is Aiki? And, of course, if I could have felt the technique of Takeda Sokaku, I would have loved to. Perhaps I wouldn't have understood anything. Probably not. I'm not smarter than anyone else. But I would have liked to see how it felt. So that's there. You know, since I moved to Japan, I've started Daitoryu. So it's going to be 9 years now. And that's really a huge part of my study of Aikido as well, Daitoryu and Aikido together. You know, it's a different time as well. Takeda Sokaku was from a samurai family. He was much older than Ueshiba Morihei. So he was really at the bridge between old and new Japan. That man used to, you know, of course, wear kimono, and within his kimono he would have razor blades just in case he would get attacked. In his cane he would have a sword in his cane just to defend himself. You know, really much a man of the past. I would have liked to see, you know, how is a man from that time behaving, talking, and practicing.
Are you much of a reader? You strike me as someone who would be consuming quite a few books.
Yes, I mean, as I told you before, I just moved houses, and my book collection is ridiculous in terms of the number of boxes that I had to pack and shelves that I had to buy. So, yes.
When it comes to martial arts books, because I'm assuming that martial arts books like make up at least a good chunk of your library, what kind of books are you reading?
Anything I can get my hands on. And in fact, I am studying Japanese nowadays almost exclusively through all martial art books. I go to to a place in Tokyo near Kanda, which has a lot of old bookstores. And I'm after old books about, you know, Budo and Aikijujutsu and Aikido and all that. And I am trying to the best of my ability to make sense of those articles, you know, with my dictionary, you know, kanji per kanji, and get the meaning of those. So that's a huge part. To give you one reference in particular, it's a little bit difficult. And in fact, that could come as surprising. You know, I have my own, you know, I need to separate what is my own. I would call that, I dare to call that academic interest in martial arts. I am an academic, I'm a scientist, but I know what it is. I know what good research is, and I think I'm doing good research in Aikido. So I dare to call that, at least informally, and in the way it's conducted, it's sort of somewhat academic research. But, you know, as far as my favorite books, these are not my favorite books. They are necessary to what I do. But, you know, favorite book, you know, there is one which was written, which is called Angry White Pyjama. Yeah. Have you heard about this?
Yes, we've talked about this book on the show.
I love that book. It's I think the author is called Robert Twigger, is it? He came to Japan and, you know, he took up a program, Kenjutsu program. Is that the way they call it in there? But anyway, it's an instructor course, one of the hardest, you know, Budo programs in Japan. And he basically relates his story of moving to Japan, living in very, very harsh conditions and undergoing even harsher training. That's a different school of Aikido. That's Yoshinkan Aikido. But I really found the book really, really interesting. Now, of course, the man is a journalist, so I am guessing, you know, there is a little bit of creative license behind it. But I really like the way it's put together. Very, very entertaining, certainly. Whereas the books I read for my research are pretty boring to, you know, most people but me.
what do you mean by that? Let's talk about that for a second.
It's a historian's job, and I was lucky because, and actually it's a good opportunity to pay credit to people who actually deserve credit. Like, we wouldn't know much of what we know about Aikido and its history if it wasn't for the work of a few individuals. One of them, his name was Stanley Pranin, who founded a journal which was called Aikido Journal, and he was in Japan long before me. And he's the one who really studied it all, like interviewing the old sensei, translating documents, and 75-80% of what we know about Aikido today is directly because of him. He passed away very recently, sadly, but we owe him quite a lot. And I was lucky enough to be in direct contact with him, if not, you know, physically with him, quite a few times. We've collaborated on a few things, and certainly a big, big influence. And other, you know, a few other people like, you know, Ellie Samdu or Peter Goldsberry. Peter Goldsberry lives in Hiroshima. He's a professor. He's a professor of philosophy at the University of Hiroshima, and, you know, very much an academic. And I'm really trying to adhere to those guys' standards when I do what I do. But it takes a bit of dedication. But I was really lucky to have those people as models, and still have some of them, like Ellie Samdur, Peter Goldsberry, people that, you know, I really ask for advice whenever I'm looking into something. And perhaps I'm lucky in the sense that I do get to learn the old techniques for real, which I'm, as far as I'm aware of, my peers don't have that either. Didn't get that opportunity, or choose not to take that opportunity. So that's what makes it very academic in nature, not very entertaining, because you have to try to do the historian's job of cutting through the embellishments, or the, not mystification, that's probably too strong of a word, but you write history, and when you write history, you write it through your own understanding of it. You need to take that neutral stance, which is what makes it a little bit tedious, is that if you take that neutral stance, you can't really enjoy it, because if you start enjoying it, then you run the risk of being stuck into the narrative of whoever wrote the book.
Okay. How about movies? I'm wondering if you have a different perspective on martial arts, mm-hmm, movies than some of our guests. Do you enjoy them?
I must admit that I don't watch too many of them. It's just because it doesn't do much for me watching martial arts on movies. I like doing it like I get it's like I suppose watching sports. I'd rather do sports than watching it on TV. Now, in terms of martial arts movies, having that interest in cinematography, in history, and all that, the obvious answer comes with the movies of Kurosawa Akira, Seven Samurai or Yojimbo or those movies, which, on top of being interesting in the way that they describe archetypes of characters, especially Seven Samurai, but they describe them, they put them in a setting which is quite truthful in the terms of where relationship go. And of course the cinematography, the scope of those movies to me is so far unequaled. So I go back to those movies quite often. Interestingly, my wife hates to watch those movies because the way they speak to each other is very rough, and she won't let my son go anywhere near those movies because she doesn't want him to start talking like this. But these are great movies, and you learn quite a bit, from them. We all have this image of the samurai, like Tom Cruise, with the wonderful hakama and kimono and so on. But most of the time butt naked and wearing whatever they had and they could. And it's more nitty gritty. It's more gritty than what it seems from the perspective of Hollywood. And the nice thing is that Kurosawa was not afraid to show that aspect of the gritty life of a lot of samurai, especially because he dealt with often with a period of almost to the point of the Meiji Restoration, where the samurai class was actually dying off. That makes it a very, very interesting period.
Let's talk about the future.
Yeah.
I know you've got a lot going on. It was because of some of the things that you have going on, and I'm going to let you speak on them, that we were introduced to you, and I appreciate what you're doing with YouTube and your other projects. But where's your motivation coming from? Is it simply a love for the martial arts, or is it more? Tell us about what you're striving for.
I am an obsessive individual, I think. I am excessive, I'm obsessive. And my wife described that she calls that otaku, the term, Japanese term otaku, which means somebody who's obsessively interested in something. So I am, from what she says, I'm a Budo, an Aikido otaku. I want to know everything there is to know about it, and I won't stop until there is nothing more to learn. But of course, because that keeps extending, an interest which started with just plain Aikido, the few 30 techniques of Aikido, went to 3,000 techniques of Daitoryu, and then the cultural ramifications, the historical context where they were born, and many, many topics. So that's a never-ending sort of quest. But my goal, of course, is always to understand what Aiki is, the concept of Aiki, which is in Aikido and Aikijujutsu. Based on the as deep of a knowledge as possible of the martial arts that came before that, and to always, whatever I do, ground it into culture. That's what I want. Which is why one of my big projects right now, more immediate project, is I am trying to get on tape the last living students of the founder of Aikido. And I've been pretty successful so far getting some of them. I still have a bit more work to do to go and talk to them and get their impressions before they're all gone. So that's more a short-term goal, but that's certainly something that takes a lot of my energy and time. Now, meanwhile, I am also an actor in that thing. I'm not only a reporter. There is what I learn and there is what I understand, and I teach that as well. And my goal is to refine that teaching, to really try to be a mirror of what Aiki is, and to give it the most the most direct representation of Aikido as much as I understand it. But of course, I can only do a good job once I truly understand it, which is far from the case. So these are huge goals of mine. I mean, they are insane goals, but you know, if you don't have those sort of overarching goals, then it's very difficult to accomplish the smaller bits along the way.
Completely agreed. So tell us more about your projects. I mean, and actually, before you do that, I'm curious, how many of O-sensei's students are still left alive?
Well, it's a good question. You know, you've got the famous ones, especially those that who moved to the West and started teaching in America, in France, and so on. And then it depends what you're calling a direct student. It's you know, I've actually asked the question to one of those students, and he said, you know, anybody who met Ueshiba and respected him can actually, in his opinion, is legitimate calling himself or herself direct student of O-sensei. So that's potentially quite a few people. But of course, the clock is ticking, and you know, it is really high time to get that done. So I'm expecting, I probably have perhaps 10 years in front of me before probably the last people who have actually did spend an extensive amount of time with him all pass away. So that's, you know, it's quite a bit of work to do.
Sure, yeah. It sounds rather daunting, but it seems like it's something that you're passionate enough about to devote the time and to actually bring it together. And
yeah, the amount of time I spend on it is ridiculous, but you know, it's just there is that drive that is there. It's hard to explain to people why I spend so much energy and time and money as well, and especially to my wife. It has to be done, and there are a few things in life that you can say, if I don't do it, who's going to do it? I don't believe anybody is irreplaceable. But really, in this case, if I'm not doing it, who is going to do it? Stanley passed away. I'm one of the only one who is still in Japan with the technical knowledge on, you know, how to roll a camera and how to, you know, record sound in a decent way. If I don't do it, I'm afraid that it's not going to be done. So it's not so much my choice, in fact. And, you know, in a way, if there are some aspects of your life that you can say, I have contributed to society in a way that, you know, not many people could have, you know, it's a good life, I think. And if it's just my little, you know, hobby of Aikido and the very few people on the world scale that it interests, it's still good enough.
And if people want to find the things that you're contributing, your YouTube channel and mm-hmm. writings, how do people find you online? And how would people get a hold of you? Tell us all that.
Yeah, so my YouTube channel has got quite a bit of traction in the last few years. So that's, and you know, for someone, especially somebody who's not a specialist in Aikido, that's perhaps a good place to start, because you've got the whole nice package to apprehend the art and the different expressions of the art from different people I interview, the different demonstrations that I shoot. And then for the people who are a little bit more experienced, there is my website where I put my interviews in a longer format, more in-depth. I've got some articles which touch upon pretty specific historical points. So that the website is probably for people who are a little bit more familiar with the art. So first route of entry would be the channel. And then, you know, I've got Twitter account and Facebook and stuff like that, but I find them they're more of a waste of time. But somehow, if you want to get your stuff out, you need to go through them, and I appreciate that, but I try not to spend too much time on it. So certainly the YouTube channel and the website.
Okay, great. And I really appreciate your time here today. You've been very open, very honest, and I thank you for all of that. If I could trouble you for one more thing, mm-hmm. what parting words would you give to the folks listening?
Well, I think what I'm trying to get really is to get the interest in the context of the martial arts and the culture. We work out, I don't like the term working out, and I believe that there should be something more, because there is something more available in any martial art. So whatever martial art you do, it'd be a shame not to associate with the culture it's from. Try to absorb it, try to be like a sponge, and you'll see that you look at the way you see things very differently. And you'll reach depth that you didn't suspect were present. So that would be one of the thing. The other thing would be like my old dietary teacher is 86 or 87. He says that martial arts, they're like a tree, and there are branches that go in all directions. Now, we've been practicing martial arts, certainly in the West, for a long time, 60 years, now 70 years. The branches have grown. The question you have to ask yourself is, what branch am I on? Who do I owe my knowledge to? And to which trunk is it leading? And if you find roadblocks, if there is no more lineage, then you get to start questioning what you're doing. It is perfectly fine for different expressions of a martial arts to grow in different directions. It's unavoidable. And as much as the Japanese try to preserve their Mukai Mukazai, these change nonetheless. They're not set in stone with generations of soke or teachers or shihan or whatever. And that's desirable because the more the branches grow, the stronger the trunk becomes. But it is very important that every branch stays connected to the trunk. And it doesn't matter which direction they go. So always look back to your lineage. Who do you owe your knowledge to? Is it a legitimate branch? Or can you start questioning your branch? Not other branches, your branch. That's in my view, that's very important. And then you're more aware of the choices which are made by your teachers, by your schools. You understand those choices. And the whole thing is a lot more productive and clearer. Then if you don't understand those choices, or if somebody cannot express them clearly to you, then it becomes dogma, and that's not helpful, I think. And finally, which is linking the two things together, once again, it's easier to be a big fish in a small pond. How do you fare in the larger scheme of things? Do you go to other places to train? Do you cross-train? Are you able to see the qualities in what other people are doing? It's very easy to be judgmental and to see what you see as flaws. But are you able to, are you mature enough? Have you practiced enough to see the qualities in what people are doing? That would be my another important advice.
I found Sensei Erard to be both insightful and contemplative about a culture that's so completely different from the one he knew growing up. His dedication to the martial arts helped him find his place in a foreign country. I enjoyed hearing that passion, not just for culture, but for his training, and I'm glad he decided to resume training after taking some time off. Thank you, Sensei Erard, for coming on the show and inspiring us to go wherever our hearts may lead us. If you want to check out the show notes with photos, links, all that, you can do so at whistlekickmartialartsradio.com. This is episode 234. If you want to find us on social media, we're all over the place at Whistlekick. If you want to email us, you can get to me directly, jeremy@whistlekick.com. If you just have some general comments, info@whistlekick.com. We keep it easy. If you want to check out the products we offer, whistlekick.com is the place to do it. I want to thank you for your time today. It means a lot that you all listen. Until next time, train hard, smile, and have a great day.